Many thanks to our panelists for joining us today and for sharing with us your insights about this very important topic. They'll be discussing not so much the outcome of the elections, which haven't been released yet, but really the challenges moving forward, what it's going to take to put together the next Iraqi government. And I want to thank SAIS, a conflict management program, for making this lovely room available to us. And a final thanks to Daniel Serwer, who has so graciously agreed to moderate today's event. He's going to be running it as a Davos-style Q&A, which is always wonderful for the audience and for the panelists, but is much harder for the moderator, who has to do all the hard work the night before. So thank you, Daniel. He has long experience working on Iraq, having served as executive director of the Hamilton Baker Iraq Study Group, as vice president of the Center of, as vice president for the Center of Peacebuilding Innovation at USIP and VP for Peace and Stability Operations. He led peacebuilding efforts in Iraq, Afghanistan, Sudan, and the Balkans, and he also wears both a SAIS and an MEI hat. At SAIS, he's a senior research professor of conflict management and a senior fellow at the Center for Transatlantic Relations, and at MEI, he's a very active scholar and contributor, for which we're very appreciative. So Daniel, thank you for taking this over, and now I'd like to hand the panel over to you.
Thank you very much, Kate. This format is also a little bit hard on the cameras. I hope they'll be they won't be too unhappy with us. We'll be speaking from here. The good news, in my way of thinking, is that the Prime Minister of Iraq, who will be Prime Minister of Iraq, is actually uncertain still. And when you think about it, that's an extraordinary statement. 15 years ago, we wouldn't have imagined such a situation. And even 6 months ago, frankly, people were in doubt whether these elections would come off. They not only came off, they weren't picture perfect. I don't know anywhere where elections are really picture perfect. There are 854 complaints filed with the Elections Commission. But my reading of the fact that there has not been a great deal of agitation about malfeasance during the electoral process is that, this is a pretty looking like a half-decent election, or better, let's put it that way. That doesn't mean there won't be complaints in the future. Counting can create complaints as well. But I think we're looking at something like a democratic process in Iraq. Paul Salem published a piece yesterday that I found quite magnificent, called Five Elections in Search of a Democratic Transition. And his point was that none of these are really democracies, but in the hierarchy, I would put Iraq pretty close to the top in terms of beginning a democratic transition. The only other one in which the outcome of the election was uncertain was Lebanon, and for quite different reasons. 60% turnout, not bad. Iraqis appear to have availed themselves of the opportunity they were offered to try to determine their next government. Now the question is how their votes will be transformed into a final product, and will the government formation process reflect the will of the people, and what, after all, was that will? And then certainly in Washington, there are some other questions on our minds. Will sectarianism continue to dominate? Will the system force a certain degree of cross-sectarian cooperation? Will Maliki get his hat trick, I think it's called in hockey, his third mandate? Having alienated his allies among the Shia Kurds and the Sunni, can he regain the majority, or is he cooked? Who could mount a viable challenge? Can they put together an ABM coalition, an anything but Maliki coalition? And is Iraq facing a long interregnum presided over by a clever and determined incumbent? And Saif, just before the event, asked another question, which I think is an appropriate one. Can Iraq survive the centrifugal forces that are at work, not only in the election, but speaking more broadly in the country, with the insurgency in some areas, with a dispute over oil, principally various aspects of oil in the north. There are a lot of centrifugal forces at work here, and you know, democracy has many virtues, but it doesn't necessarily provide the kind of strong center that that a country requires at certain moments. We've got four wonderful panelists, or at least I think we've got four. Zal will, I trust, appear, and he was, of course, ambassador in Iraq 2005 to 2007, when the constitution was approved in a referendum. So his contribution is very much present today with these elections. Now in business, Saif Abdul-Rahman helped key positions after the U.S. invasion, helping to build the Ministry of Industry, the Parliament, and the Vice Presidency. He in a way represents somebody with a lot of institutional experience, governmental experience inside Iraq. Denise Natali, who is now at NDU, she tells me she's lived 8 years in Iraqi Kurdistan, but is it pains also to remind me that she has spent 22 years going there, and certainly is one of the people who knows the ins and outs of Kurdistan extraordinarily well. Abbas Kadhim, who has recently joined us here at SAIS, is a native of Najaf and a scholar focused on the Iraqi state, the Hausa, and the Ba'ath Party. So, Abbas, let me start with you. What are we looking at here? What scenario are we in?
Well, thank you very much, and thanks to the Middle East Institute and SAIS also, my colleagues, and to you, Dan. What are we looking at? First, let me start where you left, as you know, the rating of an election like this at this time. It is important to have some perspective here that we are not talking about a well-established democracy. We are talking about a democratizing country. So that, as a former professor, that in my book, that will raise the grade not to a little bit better than half. I would put it in where in the B plus A minus, because it is really, with all of this adversity that we are seeing, an election after another, all held on time, all held with great participation, and with people dodging bullets and car bombs to do it. So that is very important, I think, in terms of the, at least, where we are going with the democratization process. To your other point, or where this is taking us, all scenarios are open, I think, at this point, because by the makeup of Iraqi society, with all of its backgrounds, political and otherwise, social backgrounds, it is very hard to tell before the elections, and this is a wonderful sign in the Middle East and in the Arab world. We are about to be a month after the election, and we don't know who the heck is going to be the winner, versus the winner being known 6-7 months before. That's another thing. So it depends, because no one in Iraq right now, a group or an ethnic background or a political bloc that can have the required seats, it's so high a threshold to form a government. So the alliances after we get the final results and they are ratified will tell us. But if you were to ask me really hard. I would say that we are going to have a status quo. I think we will be having similar to the last makeup of the government with the prime minister, the president, and the parliamentary speaker because of the reality of the division in Iraqi political backgrounds and the political atmosphere right now.
That would force a certain amount of cross-sectarian collaboration.
Yes.
First, in electing the president, because you need a two-thirds majority, if I remember correctly, to
initially,
to
but later on,
in
if
the parliament,
nobody gets it, then they will be there will be another process.
Later rounds,
yeah.
You can get 50%.
For the first two runners, whoever wins from them, 50% will do it.
Saif, is that the scenario we're in? A kind of repeat of the Maliki coalition?
Well, first of all, thank you very much. It was a kind of a strange invitation last week. I just haven't spoken for a while at any of these events, but thank you for inviting me. Thank you for the Middle Eastern Student SAIS, of course, Dan Serwer. And it's good to see that the Iraqi ambassador is attending events. This didn't happen in the past, at least when I used to speak at other events. So it's good to see you here, Mr. Ambassador, and of course, Nofal Al-Hassan, the commercial attaché. So you've got the political and the economics attending. But I kind of take a little more pessimistic view, I think, than Abbas. I think a B-plus is quite optimistic. While, yes, we have held elections, they've been on time, unfortunately, the mold has been quite similar in the elections. And as Abbas said at the end of his discussion, is we're going to be at the same place again. And the problem with that is if this was in a vacuum, that would be okay because it would go towards the whole muddling through scenarios that all of the pundits or people that think about Iraq talk about. But unfortunately, the trajectory that I see is a more downward trajectory now because of the different security and other regional forces right now that are playing a much more major role in Iraq. It used to be that there were two major regional actors, two major non-Iraqi actors, let's call them, that were sort of negotiating for the future of Iraq. And I think it's very clear who they were. I mean, one of them obviously is our eastern neighbor, Iran, and the other, for a time, was the United States. Of course, that interplayed with the internal dynamics, the politics, the ethnic, the sectarian. The difference that we have this time is you have other regional actors that are now throwing their lot in, and I think this will only serve to complicate the situation even further. It will probably make the government formation discussions a lot more difficult. And the other complicating factor is as much as I think that the Prime Minister has tried to bring about the security that he talks about, unfortunately what has happened in the process is he's alienated a lot of the political actors in the process of doing so. And I think realistically the scenario that we may be looking at as we start looking at these formation discussions is almost a repeat of 2006 with Ibrahim al-Ja'fari. Although from the results that I think I'm unofficially hearing, the Prime Minister is looking at close to 90 seats in somewhere in that range or state of law. And when you look at the other two major components of the National Alliance, your ISKI, the Supreme Council, and the Sadrist, their total seats together probably come 10 seats short of what state of law has accomplished. And I think what that will serve to do is probably lengthen the process of government formation. Maybe it's as long as we had it last time, maybe even longer. The difference this time is you have a security component dynamic that's a very dangerous dynamic, and that is not only contained in Anbar that we see on the news, it's actually in other parts. I mean, in Baghdad today we had 8 car bombs, if I'm not mistaken. You have flooding around the external suburbs of Baghdad, the southern part of Baghdad. I mean, so the situation is a lot more dire, I think, And I think it's incumbent upon the politicians to start to realize how dangerous the situation is getting. I think the scenario realistically, and I'll stop right here, is the Prime Minister has done very well, and he will probably hold out this card of the third term until at the end he'll say, okay, I won't take the third term, but this is my candidate. That's probably the scenario that I see happening as these negotiations stretch out.
You're picturing that conversation among the full political spectrum or only within the Shia part of the political spectrum?
No, I mean, I think that the conversations have already begun. All the political parties have already started talking to each other. From all of my friends that I'm talking to, including some friends in State of Law and friends in ISKI and the Sunnis and others, everyone is talking to everybody. But when I say that what I think the scenario will be is I think that you're going to have two issues. You have within the intra-Shi'i alliance, the national alliance, which you've got the major components I mentioned, and there's going to be a discussion there, and the discussion is going to end up being the Prime Minister saying, okay, we got most seats, and therefore we should propose the candidates. So if he sticks to the idea of the third term, I think it will be very hard to sell, because in the end you're going to have a parliamentary vote. And when Abbas talked about the presidency and it's two-thirds, and even an absolute majority thereafter, it's not going to be very easy. Although the Prime Minister has talked about the majority government, I don't think it's as easy as State of Law has announced that they're going to form a majority government. I know about all the people that there have been agreements, that some people will break away from their parties and join State of Law and all this stuff, but I think in light of the present political situation, it will be very difficult for the Prime Minister to stay Prime Minister. It's possible, but very difficult. But I think it's also more difficult to create a majority government, which has been talked about. I think that's why I go back to the scenario where Abbas just mentioned, that we'll go back to a similar situation that we had last time around. The difference being is the dangers for the territorial integrity of Iraq. Now, I'm not talking about Iraq breaking apart. I don't think that's the likely outcome, but I think that we're in danger of becoming close to a failed state because of all the security implications and the lack of ability to control the grounds in Iraq. The difference being is you've got oil resources, you've got Syria on one side, you've got the Turks on the other, and then the Iranians, of course. So it becomes a very dangerous and a high-stakes game.
Denise, how are you viewing this situation?
Thank you, Dan, for the invitation. I was just in the North a couple of weeks ago, and I'll try to give you what the perception is from the Kurdistan region. And one, most strikingly, you wouldn't even know that there were elections going on in Baghdad, because there were also provincial council elections. And I've got to tell you, oddly, the Baghdad elections were almost a sideshow. So most, for the Kurds up in the north, if, you know, the elections were going on in terms of, you know, the provincial council, who is going to control the provincial council elections is by far the most significant issue going on in the north right now, because it's through the councils that some of these local leaders and these party fragmentations are playing out, and who will get power. With that said, the Kurds are approaching Baghdad as they have in the past, which is how they can leverage their interests in Iraq. So the calculations are there were about 57 seats last time. The numbers going around are 57 to 60 seats. And the dominant thinking is Maliki or whatever bloc will not get enough votes. They will absolutely need the Kurds. There are different groupings among the Kurds, but the dominant, let's say Barzani, thinking is the Kurds will be still, I hesitate to use this word because I don't agree, a kingmaker, a swing vote. They will need us. This is the attitude. So it is going down to Baghdad, one, and there's not even a specific leader. There have been meetings between some of the Kurdish leadership and some of, you know, Nujafi and Alawi. But nonetheless, who the Kurds can make the best deal with, and right now in Baghdad. So it'll be a big bargain, and how they can secure their national interests. And the overriding issue in the north is the oil. So whatever group, whatever leader, the Kurds can go down with their 57 or 60 seats and say, here's our vote. You pay for our oil. You let us export, or you give us the revenues we need. So that's in terms of the Baghdad, and I don't see a major shift in that. I mean, this is the continuity. That is, there isn't much leverage. You're hearing a lot of this, the Kurds have so much leverage, they're going to break away. This is a pretty difficult situation right now. While there's development and while there's stability, there's a money issue. And so this time around, as opposed to 4 years ago, logically, it's more pressing for the Kurds to negotiate. But the other side of it is what's happened over the 4 years is you've got this very, very deep emotive oil nationalism, that the whole idea in the north, even from Gordon, is you can't even mention the idea that Baghdad would control the oil. It's being written as being anti-Kurd. So you have to do it in a different way. This is going to make, for me, negotiations much more grueling between the Kurds and the next Iraqi leadership, because it's been now, the discourse is now a very emotive one, it's a moral one, and it's penetrated throughout Kurdish society. That is why, even I think, even with Goran, even if the PUK, who are a bit more flexible in terms of negotiating with Baghdad, there's only so far they can go in making any agreement with any other bloc. We've heard things like, well, perhaps one of the Kurdish groups will deal with one coalition and the Barzani group will deal with another. That is possible. But when it comes to key Kurdish nationalist issues in Baghdad, they have to stay together. They have to remain unified. So I see a continuity. I don't see, you know, this idea of Kurds separating and breaking away. I think this is just a lot of still hype. But they will try to leverage as much as they can this time the idea that they've got these valuable resources and these votes that the next prime minister needs.
The Kurds have been very disappointed in Maliki's fulfillment of what they regard as firm agreements. Are they prepared to trust him again?
I don't know. There's this issue of trust and there's the issue of financial demands right now. When you don't have any money in your bank accounts and you have to pay international oil companies, moreover, you have to pay civil servant salaries. You know, you've got 70% of the budget is to civil servant salaries, and there are demonstrations going on today. So the idea of trust will always be there, but again, the stakes are much higher now. They're higher logically to negotiate because they've got to pay salaries. There's no revenue source coming in. So we have to really keep that in mind. And there is a whole, remember, the leadership, we saw this in Turkey. The president of the region, Barzani, he's got a lot of support because he's delivering services, development, all that's coming from Baghdad. All of the money to develop the north has come from Baghdad. So, again, there's this idea of disappointment because Maliki hasn't followed through, but there's also going to be pressure from the Kurds themselves to be more transparent in the way they conduct their business so that they can get paid. I would see it that way.
Zal, I had initially intended to start with you and to ask you which scenario you think we're in, because you had been talking pre-election about various scenarios. It sounds to me, if Saif is right, as if the Prime Minister has done very well. And just as important is that his opposition has not done so well. He's facing a much more fragmented opposition than previously. So how do you see the situation and especially the government formation process?
Well, thank you. My apologies for being late due to Washington traffic.
We're delighted to have you here,
Zal. Thank you. I think as far as the scenarios are concerned, I had thought before elections that there might be three scenarios. One in which the Prime Minister and Dawlat al-Qanun, the state of law, does poorly, and I had characterized that in my mind between 60 to 80. Or it does very well, extremely well, I said over 100. And the middle was kind of 90-ish. Now we heard, I think, that the speculation is it could be around 90. So it's a middle scenario, and he will be, the Dawlat al-Qanun or the state of law will be the largest grouping. But can it form the government? Can it have enough of an understanding with others to be able to solve the presidency issue, because usually you get a package deal. I'm sure this has been discussed before, but also to form a government with the prime minister at the top. I have thought that if it was less, 60 to 80 in that range, Prime Minister Maliki, although even if he had the biggest bloc, he would be in trouble. If he had over 100, it would be difficult to stop him. But if he is in the middle range, it makes it a little uncertain, unpredictable. Government formation will be difficult, therefore, and I would say either he is able to form a government, but a majoritarian government, which he's talked about, based on efficiency, effectiveness of the government, which is perfectly understandable, is probably going to be very difficult to do. I know that even when I was there, he was not happy about this emphasis on a broad-based government. He even thought the presidential system. He knew that I had worked on the Afghan constitution before coming to Iraq to work on the Iraqi constitution. That would have been the best thing for Afghanistan, for Iraq too, if there was a powerful chief executive elected directly by the people. So. Yeah, majoritarian government that he wants for understandable reasons is going to be difficult. What Iraq needs, again, because of the challenges that it is facing, greater sectarianism, even as we heard about the North, more problematic relations between Baghdad and Erbil than at times in the past. Moving to what the era, if you like, of the 2007, 8, 9, 10 period policies of a grand bargain among the political parties, national unity, integration of Sunnis into the political process, as well as the Kurds and the Shia, is necessary to deal with this phase. And I believe that somebody said it maybe like 2006, which I remember extremely well since I was there, is that the initial nominee could be one person, and the final result of who becomes the prime minister could be someone else, and therefore there is the risk of a very protracted period of government formation. When I was there, it lasted at least 4, maybe 5 months. Last time it was 9 months, so there is a risk that it could last longer. And given the challenges that we heard that Iraq faces, this is going to be extremely negative, could be have a negative effect on the situation further. So I think this election is extremely important, and what Iraq is facing because of the internal and regional situation in which Iraq finds itself. I am concerned that if this doesn't go well, then Denise was, for example, that the Kurds, at least the Kurdish leadership, is seriously thinking about asking for a change in the structure of Iraq, not to go for independence completely to leave Iraq, but de facto to go for a propose a confederation. President Barzani has talked about it in various interviews in recent times, in which it will be based on sovereignty, that Kurdistan will become sovereign but remain part of Iraq in a confederation, that there has to be a renegotiation of the essential constitutional deal that would give them the right, in their view, to be able to export oil and to conduct some of the other things that are attributes of the federal government or the responsibilities of the federal government. And then we know what's going on in terms of Anbar and Baghdad relations. I think this is the result of some of the mistakes in policy in Iraq, but also because of the competition that has resulted between major regional powers after the U.S. departure, and it has to do situation in Syria in particular that has had a very negative effect on Iraq.
That's where I thought I'd turn to next. We talked about a lot of the internal factors, but I think we need to talk about the external factors as well.
Sure.
There's the influence, the effect of the war in Syria. Mm-hmm. There's the question of Iran's preferences within Iraq. There's the question of Turkey, especially its relationships to Baghdad and to Erbil. And rarely spoken of because it's so opaque, there's the question of the relationship with the Saudis, which never seems to quite get sorted out. So I wonder if I could invite maybe you first, Denise, to talk about whatever you like, but I'm thinking in part at least about the relationship with Turkey and the influence of the war in Syria on the Kurdish perception.
This has been extremely important for the Kurds. Largely, one, this is a landlocked region. And it's a region that is not an externally sovereign state. The Kurds do, as Ambassador said, are now seeking confederation, but I don't see that likely. So they are highly dependent on these regional states. Now, most of us know, and I don't want this to be oversimplified by saying there's a Barzani group aligned with Turkey and a PUK group aligned with Iran, because they're all benefiting here. However, with that said, we all are aware that the role of Turkey in the Kurdistan region has been monumental, not only in terms of helping to reconstruct the region, but in terms of new political pacts and security arrangements between the Kurdistan regional government, particularly the Barzani leadership and Prime Minister Erdogan. Now, what have been the implications of that has been, as the Syrian civil war continued, you start now having this trans-border Kurdish politics, and you have two dominant factions or groups right now really defining this politics, which is the Barzani faction and the Abdullah Öcalan faction, playing out in Syria, and this really is playing out against the Turkey-Barzani relationship. And I'll give you an example. This is pretty strong inside the region, so that when these Kurds in Syria declared an autonomous region and everybody else, all the other Kurds, recognized it, but the Kurdistan regional government or the Barzani group didn't, because the other two Kurdish groups did. So there's a lot, there's been thousands of demonstrations. There's a trench being built, a 17-kilometer long, 3-kilometer wide trench along the Kurdish-Syrian border, along with Turkey, and there's been demonstrations. So there are some political issues, stability issues. But we also should look at Iran. And so there's been, one could say Turkey has played a positive role, and there's also been some unintended consequences of the Turkish-Barzani relationship playing out in intra-Kurdish power struggles. I want to make a point about the Iranian role, which is actually, may seem, unexpected, but nonetheless, they're actually playing a more of a mediating role. The decline of influence of the PUK has actually now, they're turning to Iran. So when this lack, the Kurdistan regional government still hasn't formed its government after 7 months or 8 months since their elections. And many of these PUK leaders have gone to Tehran. They continue to seek Iranian negotiation in trying to make a deal. And when we're looking at what happens in Baghdad, we should certainly know for the Kurds, Iran will play a very significant role, far more than Turkey, in terms of who gets what. The Iranians are trying to assure their PUK leaders still remain influential. That means maybe the presidency trying to influence the Kurdistan regional government to keep the PUK involved. So there, and of course, Iran has no interest in seeing their interests weakened in Baghdad or to see an Iraqi central government weakened. So there's actually two very distinct roles being played out by Turkey and Iran. Some of the Kurds, it depends where you are. If you're at the Duhok border, there's a different view. If you're at the Suli-Iran border, there's a different view. But those certainly in Suli, I've heard this many, many times, they would prefer to be dealing with Iran than Turkey. They see Iran as a more stabilizing influence in the region than Turkey. So you have to, it really depends on who you're talking to, but there certainly is a division among these groups in terms of these regional alliances. Thank you.
Thank you. Saif. I'm going to work my way back this way.
I think I mentioned the regional as well the international aspects in the first part of my discussion. I think, unfortunately, Iraq is going to be subject to a much larger and broader issue, and that's probably kind of a grander scheme between what happens between Iran and the United States on the nuclear file, and Syria and Lebanon. And as much as I hate to say it, and I wish this wasn't the case, but reality probably dictates that if things go south in Syria, for example, for the Iranians, and they feel that the regime is threatened, more than likely they will want to make sure that Iraq doesn't want to go off the rails by any means. But it seems that the tide is turning towards the regime more so in Syria. And that would tend to tell me, from an analysis perspective, that they would allow some sort of change in Iraq to make sure that Iraq remains some sort of a stable state. You know, we always talk about Saudi Arabia, and the Saudis probably played and try to play a role, but in reality, I think that with an aging monarch that dictating almost all of Iraq policy, there's not much Iraq gets on his radar. If you think about, he's running a country, how many hours is he running, you know, of a day of running the country, and then you have Iraq policy. I don't see Saudi Arabia playing as major a role in Iraq as many of the Iraqis and others see it. But I think Turkey is going to start playing a much more assertive role and has done so by inviting many of the different Iraqi factions. While the Turks want to try to exert their influence, I think that they will have a very difficult time overcoming the overbearing Iranian influence in the region. So if I was to look at the situation, I think Iraq's stability probably is going to be dictated by the internal issues that we talked about, but on the external level, more likely between a more grand bargain or some sort of an agreement between Iran and the United States, or let's say the Iran and the rest of the world, on the nuclear file of Syria and other situations. The one dynamic that is a potentially disturbing dynamic in all of that scenario is Al-Qaeda, obviously the terrorists. You know, the people talk about ISIL, the Islamic State of Iraq and the Levant, Daesh, as it's known. You know, Daesh is an animal of regional power also. While some countries in the region felt that they may have had some control over it, I think that is starting to diminish. And you know, as these guys, I mean, they're almost guns for hire in many ways. And I think they can play a destabilizing influence in Iraq, because what's happening is, while the external regional dynamics have been playing a role, the reality is, with the fighting that's happening in Anbar and with the destruction of property, with the flooding, even though it may not be the government doing all of it, the government's doing some of it, but the people will end up seeing, okay, this is what's happening to me. And we start having a repeat of a situation where these extremists come to the people and say, oh, look what the government has done to you. You've got to come join us. And they've, from what I've heard, the reports is they've gotten a lot more savvy about approaching the people, learning from their past mistakes, For example, I read a report from some people on the ground that they approached some hospitals in Anbar with container loads of medical supplies that they stole from the Iraqi government, and they're coming and telling the people, oh, we're here to help you and to serve you. So that's the dangerous dynamic that I think, and while some regional countries think they may be able to tamper or put a control, I think the reality is that those guys are kind of the wild card in this scenario, and they can play a very destabilizing role for Iraq as it spreads. Because we talk about Anbar, but Mosul is in crisis. Salah ad-Din is in a very problematic state. Diyala isn't much better. So when you look at the central part of Iraq right now, and just so that you get an idea, and I was mentioning this to Paul Salim as we were walking in, you know, when you hear that Abu Ghraib is no longer under government control or is under tenuous government control, that's like from here to National Airport. I mean, because Baghdad International Airport sits on the corners of Abu Ghraib, so the edge of Abu Ghraib. So it's a very dangerous situation, and I still don't see that the politicians, you know, we're still talking about the people. We're talking, is it Maliki? Is it Chalabi? Is it Shahristani? We should be talking about the policy, because it's going to be the policy that dictates whether Iraq can be a real state, or will it turn into, you know, unfortunately, a more of a failed state where areas that aren't governed by the government, that aren't governed by the central government. And the reaction of the Kurds on this confederal issue is just, again, it's part of it. It's a symptom for this overarching failure of policy that I think needs to be addressed more than whether it's going to be Prime Minister Maliki or it's going to be Adil or it's going to be some other politician, because the policy is the policy. You know, he's not going to pull something out of his hat to solve Iraq's problems. And I think we're right on the brink. And unless we start on a corrective path, we're going to see a very dangerous situation in Iraq. Much higher stakes, because Syria is still not stable. You've got, you know, the whole Turkey situation. You've got oil and gas and resources at stake. And it gets very dangerous when you look at the broader picture.
Thank you. I'm going to turn to Abbas and to Zal, but right after that, we'll turn to the audience for questions, so get them ready. Abbas.
Okay, thank you. Well, looking at the regional, the regional powers are as strong and as important as their friends inside Iraq are. If you are Iran, for example, and you have the majority who are your potential friends, you have more leverage inside the process of Iraq, the political process in general. Iran's interests are, I see them as follows. One of them is basically to maintain the Iraqi stance on Syria, and they do like Prime Minister Maliki's plan and action for Syria, an action that is quite frankly more viable has been than others, and Iran like that, so they want that to continue. They are if one of the things that they will consider if there is a Prime Minister that is coming to Iraq, what he will be doing with Syria. The other issue is internal. Iran is interested in having a strong position for the Shia, but not too strong to be out of the Iranian management possibilities. They do not want a very strong Shia who's able to tell the Iranians sorry too many times. So that's why you see them not wanting to alienate anyone, but also supporting one group and another in a dynamic that keeps the Shia quasi-united, but not fully united, to a point where they develop an interest of their own. It's a safety margin for the Iranians. A third thing for Iran is the economic and the religious part, and this is very important. However, Iran's hands in Iraq are often overrated. First, because if you look at the population, there isn't that much support inside Iraq for a strong Iranian role. Even the Mirja'iya, I did speak with Sistani's son for quite a long time, and most of the talk that he was bragging about being able to contain Iranian influence in Najaf and beyond, and they do want to have the Shia of Iraq to develop an interest of their own, not to give up a lot of power to the Iranians, because there is a lot of dynamic going on in the Mirja'iya itself and also in what it wants for the Iraqi people. Their Iranian strong interest in Iraq or strongest influences over the political parties, and not all of them also. So we have to really be careful when we speak about that. The Turks are the same. I mean, I would defer to my friends on what they said about the Turks, but the Turks initially started as a very positive influence in Iraq in the beginning after 2003. Then Erdogan's government turned to be playing a very negative role, to the point of having sort of shouting words against the Iraqi government over sectarian issues. Then their role in the past months has faded much because they put a lot of investment of their interest in the Syrian issue. So they left Iraq a little bit towards more interest in Syria, not to mention the internal problems the Turkish government has, and with all of the issues of corruption and other internal dynamics in Turkey. I would give more to the Saudis. The Saudis are a menace towards Iraq. They have never given Iraq any serious interest in establishing diplomatic relations. In the Gulf, most of the money that comes to the terrorism is there. The ideology that is the venom that hits Iraq hard comes from Saudi mosques. Now, there are other people who slice the issue, saying, well, it's not government. There isn't really a defined line in any Gulf states between what is government and what is private. And when they want to have an ironclad against some, barrier against something, they will have it. When they want to have a laissez-faire, they do. So it is very important to really give much more rate to the Saudis. And what makes it even worse is that everything that goes on in the area, not just in Iraq, in Syria, and Lebanon, and Yemen, and Bahrain, it is all there is a dimension of an Iranian-Saudi conflict and competition over a foothold, and wherever one of them loses some foothold, they want to compensate elsewhere. So I would give more. I mean, you are right, the Saudis, they are the easier target when it comes to blaming, but it is not really paranoia. It's a healthy paranoia when you think about the Saudis if you are from the inside Iraq. The rest of the, I think, if you inject the U.S. and the beyond the other international interest in this election, the ambassador is quite, really right, and in terms of looking at it as a very important election, not just for Iraq, not just for the region, but also for the international community, because the United States right now is facing a very important juncture where the U.S.-Iraqi relations are going. The ambassador has talked until he's blue in the face about the importance of really activating U.S.-Iraqi agreements, and not to let all of the work that has been done by both countries to go in vain because of sort of someone sleeping on the switch. That's very important. And this election, if anything, it has the potential of writing the at least short-term future of Iraq in terms of who will be taking over and what kind, more importantly, as Saif said, not just who will be, because this election sadly has been over just whether or not Maliki will stay with all of the problems Iraq is facing, but what kind of governance will we have? Maliki or someone else, is he going to be able to form and craft a policy that will take Iraq out of the so many problems on so many fronts, economic, social, religious, sectarian, that is, political, security-wise, all services, governance in general. Or is he going to be stuck for the next 4 years talking about, who is in charge of what and who is to blame for every next failure? That is what is important. And for a country like the United States, for the region itself, in fact, if there is any wisdom that is there in several capitals, they have to look at what potential setbacks that will be there if Iraq fails to form. I mean, look what the problems that are happening from the Syrian state's failure. Look at the problems that have been happening with Egypt not trying to really form a functional political atmosphere inside its borders. Libya, etc. You can't really look at the problems of a country are problems within the border of the country. We just read about reports that are some of the problems in Syria and in Iraq right now are sort of forming inside Saudi and inside several other countries. Qatar has been suffering troubles. These are never problems that are confined within a border. And that is, I think, the big picture that we have to focus on when we look at the region and the world beyond and towards the Iraqi election and what potential that could come through.
Thank you, Abbas. Sal?
I think the starting point has to be Iraq itself. We have to say among ourselves that the basic problem is because there is an absence of consensus among key Iraqi players about what kind of Iraq, how much power should the center have, what center the governance should be organized, the political process by which the country should be governed at the center, the relationship between the center and the governorates, the constitution made some progress towards a national compact, and then with some agreement that some aspects of the constitution will be reviewed to broaden the support for the national compact. I think that still is unfortunately absent. That is a degrees of loyalty to this new Iraq that varies between the different Iraqis. And I think as long as there isn't a true national compact among the key players about what does it mean now to be an Iraqi, how do we organize ourselves to serve the people and to be citizens of Iraq rather than be a Shia or a Sunni or a Kurd, but to be citizens to perform based on the set of rules that they have agreed to, they're going to be vulnerable to regional players. Which I wanted to say this to get to the regional context, because it is the Iraqi internal context to some extent that provides that facilitates the negative regional role. And there is no question that in the aftermath of this U.S. withdrawal, which created a vacuum, regional factor has become much more important. Relatively speaking, it never was absent. It has become more important. And there is, unfortunately, the Iraq change is occurring and maybe contributing to it at a time that what has gained is the sectarian and ethnic identity. Little identities, smaller identities have become more important. There was a time that, Islamic identity or Arab identity were the big ideas. They are no longer the big ideas. It may be in some people's mind, but politically relevant identity right now is sectarian and ethnic. And this is tearing Iraq to a degree apart. Iraq is a victim of this. It may be contributing to it too, but it's to a victim. So what you need, in my view, if you are talking about overcoming this, and we should not exaggerate the regional role, the players, even Iran, there are limits to what it can do. For example, the Iranians, there was Denise mentioned the role of PUK with Iran being so close. I mean, they've been trying for months to get an agreement among the PUK leaders about a leadership solution to the problem. There have been visits to Tehran, NOC documents prepared by Haji Soleimani and others, and where is that? It's still, the struggle goes on. So local factors are very important. One shouldn't underestimate those. But they make a difference at the margin, the significant difference. So I think without an internal compact, to expect wisdom from the regionals to come together in the interest of Iraq and to some extent their own interest, I think would be expecting too much. But to get to a consensus in the near term seems very difficult. And therefore, what do you do in this environment to make progress? To make progress in the right direction. And my judgment is that, one, we need a more active U.S. role. I agree with this idea that we have important strategic interests in Iraq. We have moral responsibility also, besides the strategic interest issues. I could talk a lot about both of those issues, but I won't. And I think we still have good relations, understanding with a lot of Iraqis because of the experiences of the last 10 years or so. We can try to move Iraq closer towards a national consensus or a compact still. That's an unfinished agenda. We made some good progress for a while, but it has now degraded. And two, we also can play with some of the regional players also a role to avoid some of the most negative we need to help Iraq become stronger to deal with some of the terrorist threats that it faces that is a result of some of its own mistakes, yes, but mostly because of outside reasons. And maybe even in the worst of times, in terms of the situation in Iraq, we did have direct or indirect contacts and discussions with the Iranians too. Although the focus is largely on nuclear, and everything else has to go through the nuclear agreement. That sort of is the agreement. I personally favor to broaden the dialogue with Iran. It shouldn't be just nuclear. We have a lot of other important issues to talk to them about, and Iraq is certainly one. And on some of the issues, I think our views may not be that different from each other. On some, I'm sure it will be. So. I would, because I don't want to take time from the questions, that time is short, I would emphasize the issue of Iraqis coming together. That's the key. I think, unfortunately, majoritarian ideas, although it makes sense from a decision-making point of view and implementation, but you have this huge political problem that you need to address to bring the people together. So. Can you get through this post-election, given the serious crises facing the country, a wake-up call to get a true consensus? And that means compromises on some key issues. Why not allow, I do not understand Prime Minister Maliki's position, for example, to be against legitimate constitutional moves by some provinces to become federal regions if they want to. If they follow the constitution, why not? Why not find a formula for being a fault line state that Iraq is? It should follow a balanced foreign policy. Shouldn't necessarily take the Iranian lead on Syria? Why? And therefore cause a three foreign policies towards Syria from Iraq. The government and then the Anbaris or others, and then the Kurds. What is a consensus foreign policy that can help the internal cohesion of Iraq. I think those are the on oil, for example. Why can't revenue sharing be done by the companies selling the oil, those who produce, sell it, and send 83% or 83% to the government, 13% to the region, if that's the division, so that all sides,
17.
The record shows 17%.
Whatever it is, 17%, whatever the number is that they agreed to, that they agreed to, why not companies just do it? If they do it everywhere else, why can't they do it? And I mean, I'm saying, is there one trying to build a consensus on a few things that that are so fundamental that can bring the country together? And I think the U.S. role in all of this is important. I hope we'll come to that more as we go into the discussion from the floor.
Let me sum up this part of our proceedings just by saying that I think the picture that's emerging is one of a decent election, a difficult political process ahead for many reasons, with much higher stakes than before, which gives me pause, I confess, because I thought the stakes were pretty high the last time around.
It always has been since.
Let me open it then to questions. We have about 20 minutes for questions right down here. Wait for the microphone, please.
Robert Friedman at Johns Hopkins University. Ambassador Khalilzad, nice to see you again.
Nice to see you, sir.
I appreciate your desire and that of the ambassador for closer U.S.-Iraqi relations.
Right.
However, we are blessed, for better or worse, with the President of the United States whose mantra appears to be, I got us out of Iraq, I'm getting us out of Afghanistan, I'm not getting us involved in Syria. With that type of leadership at the top, how do you really expect the U.S. to get more intensively involved in Iraq?
Well, I really think leadership is important. I understand the President understands what the mood of the country is, and I have no quarrel with that, that the mood of the country is towards limiting engagement, especially if it involves military engagement. But my view is that the president has to worry in terms of the national interests of the United States, leaving the debate about who was right, who was wrong about Iraq behind us. He is now the president. He can take credit for withdrawal of all forces. I personally did not favor that, withdrawal of all forces, but he's the president. We couldn't come to the kind of agreement he said he was negotiating with the Iraqis. But now what do we do? There is a potential that in the Syrian-Iraqi border area, you could have something worse than we had in the borderlines of Afghanistan and Pakistan with Al-Qaeda. That could pose a threat not only to the neighborhood, but beyond the area to the United States. Do we want that to fester and grow, and then we will have to do something huge down the road? We have an interest in the Middle East generally, not falling apart over a broader sectarian conflict that destabilizes Iraq, has already destabilized Syria, destabilized some of the Gulf states. Maybe lead to a regional conflict, sucking the major powers on different sides. These are issues. We are dependent on energy from the area's decline, but nevertheless, it's a global market. Still, there is huge concentration of energy in that part of the world. Disruption there could affect everyone. So, yes. The Iraq war was unpopular. Yes, there is still a debate whether we did the right thing or not by going in. Can we not talk about what do we do now with the circumstances that we have faced? And we're not talking about the U.S. forces going in to reoccupy Iraq. What we're talking about is a range of activities, mostly diplomatic and some security, that assists in this and limiting the risks and helping move things in a more positive direction. And I believe that with perhaps broader discussions, with maybe pressures from people who pay attention, maybe the administration can adjust its position, as it has adjusted on other issues. I'm not entirely pessimistic that an adjustment in the way that I described cannot be made.
I might just intervene myself to say that one of the things that concerns me is overemphasis on the military aspects. Not that I'm unaware of the security dimension, it's terribly important.
Right.
But what concerns me as much is that the United States has a strategic cooperation agreement with Iraq that has important civilian dimensions of education, energy, right, culture, other things, and is doing very little to fulfill its part of the bargain other than in the energy area,
right,
which is definitely important and which I've written about as well. But there's much more to be done. There's much more to the relationship between two mature democracies than just the military aspects and the energy aspects. And what we want out of Iraq is a mature democracy, and the way, right, to get it is to be more supportive of the civilian side of things.
And I agree with this, and I think that our whatever security assistance and military relationship we have, which I support, it has to be kind of conditioned and influenced and informed by the broader agenda that we have talked about and discussed that's needed.
I think I had Judith here.
So we have real experts here.
Yeah. I'll agree with you basically that the focus on counterterrorism and the military and what are we going to do, that just takes all the oxygen out of the room.
Right.
The real issue is why aren't we, the United States, doing more to build on this strategic framework? Because,
right,
in the long term, that's where the solution is. But I didn't want to talk about that. I want to go back to more to Iraq-centric and to what Dan left us or started with, and that is, can Iraq survive? What kind of question? I mean, why not? It's survived everything else so far. So this is the worst crisis than the one before. But Iraq has shown an ability, despite all the differences and divisions, to come up with solutions. And I have no doubt that something will come up again. But the point I wanted to, or the question I wanted to clarify or ask is, what's the alternative? And I think Iraqis understand that they really don't have much of an alternative. So then it's in the fine tuning. Now, are we assuming, for purposes of the real important coalition, if you will, is not the one that happened before the election. It's like in the last election. What happens in this new, the reformed coalition after the election? Because that's how Maliki got the prime ministership. He stole it, if you will, or he was clever in recreating a coalition that gave him what he wanted. However you look at it, it's what's going to happen again. But this time it's different, it seems to me, that each one of these blocs, whether you look at the Sunni Arabs, totally in disarray. There's nothing there. There's no leadership. There's no consensus. The Kurds, wow, what a time. Total disarray again. Undecided, yeah, the most important issue is who's going to be the president and who's going to control. Do they care about Baghdad? Not really, but the point is disarray and I think indecision again. Which brings us to this question. Are we assuming that the coalition, the new post-election coalition, will include ISKI and the Sadrists? Because they've been pretty clear, we're not going to cooperate. This is a different kind of election, run on different terms, on a more local basis. If they don't cooperate, and Maliki turns to the Kurds, does he have enough to get that slim majority? I don't. The math doesn't work for me, even if we make certain assumptions about how many votes, it's going to be 80 or whatever. And if he doesn't, what does he, or even if he does, what does he promise? Because the new danger is, and the Kurds have said it very clearly, we own the presidency, we own the foreign ministry, we own anything else that we've been given already. If you want to allow that, then you turn to the new Kurdish president, whether it's Hoshiar or whoever they come up with. But the question is, if Maliki wants to have some kind of a facade of unity and of building some kind of a bridge to bring the Sunnis back in, he made deals, if I'm correct. Maybe I'm making this up. I don't think so. Wasn't there once a deal with some of the Sunni leaders that he would be interested in supporting a Sunni Arab for president, like Ujafi? Oh, you know, or something. Would that not, that would deliver a certain number of votes to get him over the top. So in other words, what I'm asking is, if you want to know where we're going, these are the parts that you have to look at, I think.
Yeah. So Judith invites us to look a little bit more closely at what a governing coalition might look like, who might participate, what the deals might consist of. Abbas?
Let me do that, since I didn't address the domestic or the internal issues in the first question as much. Here is the deal. There are two dynamics going on. One is that the biggest group has to go to its own component, that is, to name names, Maliki has to go to the rest of the Shia. And then once he finishes with whatever deals he can get, then he goes beyond to deal with the, you know, quote-unquote partners, that is the Kurds and the Sunnis. The Shia, inside, you know, when, you know, I don't see how the other groups can forget or somehow wave a magic wand and let everybody not put their sight on 90 seats. And also, not to mention the huge turnout that voted for Maliki personally. That is, if the election was about Maliki, most of the slogans were change, that is, change Maliki. And then he gets this huge number in Baghdad, and then, you know, and the list sweeps all the Shia or any governorate that is south of Baghdad, and then gets almost half of the seats in Baghdad. You know, if it is impossible for him to form a government, it will, or if it is hard for him to form a government, then it will be impossible for someone who got 20, 30 seats to do it. You know, 90 seats are closer in the logic. Now, here's what goes on inside the Shia issue. The Shia will have to ultimately go back to be united. One reason is because it is very hard for a group of them to go and caucus with the Kurds and the Sunnis. What are they going to give to those, and what are they going to take from them? It is almost impossible. Their only safe zone is to go together. The ones who are against Maliki are two kinds. Ones who are completely unpredictable. Tomorrow they can turn on a dime. That's the Sadrists. Last time they had 40 seats and they did the same. So these, they will be left to the very last to talk to them. The ones who are more pragmatic are the ISKI, the Supreme Council, the Majlis. The Majlis have one interest only. They hope to have a prime minister from them. That's what it is. But not really a complete veto against Maliki. They know they can do business with Maliki, and indeed they have in the past. It is going to be really easy for them to see their interests going together much more than going any group of them going there. Let's remember also past experience. Shia politicians have gone their way before and caucused with Sunni list. You know, Hassan al-Alawi and 20 others. And what did they get from that experience? They did not get even a secretary of a committee in the parliament. Everything, and that's why they pulled out of the Al-Iraqiyya immediately after the spoils were sliced. So they know they cannot really go anywhere and get anything or offer anything. It is very hard for me to see the Shia tell Maliki, forget it. However, I think it is possible what Saif said. You know, if Maliki kind of receives an absolute veto from the rest of the Shia, and along the lines of Sadr said, then they will probably try to get some kind of a compromise. I have put public the other day a possibility that there is a face-saving way. You will not push Maliki completely out and send him to retire or to be in the parliament, but give him the presidency, a Putin-like scenario, and then have him choose one from his coalition to be the prime minister, and then find a way to, you will get a plurality coalition, because in order to get the sort of national unity, you have to give the speakership to one, the same way the status quo is. But if that is one way, I don't know if Maliki will accept that, maybe with a deal or a promise that the powers will be expanded a little, having a team between him as a president and the prime minister from Dawlat al-Qanun, that would be. But that, you know, probably will be the absolute last resort if every Shia, I would swear that they would never accept Maliki. And I don't see why Al-Majlis or others, you know, Al-Maliki didn't do anything to them to a point that they will have that strong a veto. If you listened to Baqir Jabr, and I will close with this, talking the other day, spoke for half an hour about this issue, he did not really put a veto. All what he said, which he opened all of the possibilities, he said, we want to have a coalition, he called it the new coalition, that everybody will come and we will not talk about the prime minister first. In other words, he said, he didn't say that the new coalition should exclude Maliki, but let's decide that after we create an institution, we call it the new national coalition, that is the Shia coalition, and then we decide if Maliki, through the process of that new coalition, wins, then so be it. If someone else does, so be it. So, you know, again, ultimately, I go back to my first statement, you know, it is impossible to forget 90 seats or so and Maliki's vote that is way above 500,000.
Saif?
Yeah, I actually disagree a little. I mean, the presidency scenario is kind of pretty far-fetched.
I know, it's hard.
I mean, good luck dislodging the Kurds. Then you want to tell the Sunnis also that it's going to. But as I said, I think the dynamics and the numbers, I completely agree. The 90, if that's what it ends up being, is going to be completely very difficult to overcome. But at the same time, the 2/3 and then the 50% thereafter is also difficult. And that's kind of the thing that's built into the system that makes this so hard, right? Because, okay, 90 seats, add to it, other seats. You still, if you add all of the so-called Shia seats together, you get a little bit over half, maybe. But you still are not close to the 2/3 for the presidency, which is a deal. Yes, then you go off to a runoff if it doesn't happen, but it's still very difficult to maintain that throughout. I still think that what's going to end up happening is, you know, you're going to have this protracted situation. I really see a almost a repeat of 2006, and ironically, you're sitting right here, Ambassador. I personally remember a conversation where Ambassador was standing with my boss at the time, Hachim, in the parliament, and thinking, oh, what are we going to do? And, you know, you started talking about Maliki. I think he walked by while you were talking at the time, and others. But I think that we're going to end up having a situation like that. But going to Judith's question, the stakes are different, Judith. Yeah, you take a long view. You've been involved in Iraq work for a long time. I spoke with Phoebe last week or the week before, the same long view. But the difference this time is that the external regional dynamics are a little more unstable. The internal dynamics are becoming very unstable. And you don't have the balancing factor of the United States in the mix, and that's a big problem right now for Iraq, and you know, when we talk about U.S. role, I wasn't assuming military at all. I think General Austin was in Baghdad yesterday, or may still be in Baghdad, talking about some of the security issues associated with the counterterrorism, and I think that's very important. But I think what we need to do as the United States is, again, stop focusing on the person and start focusing on the policy, and start putting together a list of things. Okay, well, Iraqi government, regardless of who you are, you want our Apache helicopters, you want, you know, the Hellfire missiles, you want the security, the targeting, all this stuff. These are the things that have to happen in the country so that when we give you those things, they're actually useful. Because what the lessons we've learned over the last 10 years was, no matter how powerful the U.S. military was, you could not stamp out an insurgency until you began to effect the policies that are necessary to undermine the wind and the gas that fuel that insurgency. And that was the biggest lesson, I think, that was learned. And what the surge did was to create the space and to create the goodwill. And I think what has happened since is we've lost that goodwill. So it's almost necessary for the Iraqi leadership to realize, and I'm not talking about the Prime Minister alone, I'm talking about all of the Iraqi leadership. Ambassador Khalilzad mentioned the consensus. Today, there is still not a unified Iraqi vision for the state. And that is the reason for everyone pulling in different directions. And I think once you start to move towards that vision, you start to undermine the insurgency, and then you start to utilize the technical, the tools, the weapons and whatnot. But it has to be policy. And if I was to give any advice to the administration here, I would say start devising what are the policy things that need to happen, regardless of who becomes Prime Minister of Iraq, that we need to work with that Prime Minister on in order to fix the situation.
I'm going to have to warn us that we only have a couple of minutes left. I'm going to go to Denise and Zal to wrap up with whatever they like.
Sure. Thanks. Judith, I want to answer your question too. What governing coalition? At minimum, I would say the Kurds, for the fact that they're talking about 57 to 60 seats. So they will be, I would assume, part of any governing coalition. But I would also emphasize that you said the word disarray, and I agree. The North is in disarray politically in some ways, because there's a whole reorganization right now of power sharing, even in the North. But when it comes to dealing with Baghdad, they will remain united. They have to. I mean, we could see a scenario where perhaps some PUK and some Garan try to make deals with other coalitions. But at the end of the day, there's the three key national issues, right? Land, oil, and revenues. And you cannot be a Kurdish party, no way, and go down to Baghdad and cut a deal that would be perceived as being anti-Kurd. You'll lose votes in the North. And at the end of the day, that's what it's about, going back to your constituencies and showing that you are a Kurdish nationalist. So in Baghdad, Kurds will have to be united. I also think there's a lot more at stake, but I'm going to deviate a bit from Saif. There's a lot more at stake in terms of the regional dimensions and the security threats, but there's a lot at stake financially. And the other stake is they've got a lot vested, the Kurdish parties, the leadership, the government, in this economic success story, if you want what you want to call it. So to see any form of sustained...
Not me.
Oh. Sorry, it's my gong. On the one hand, you want to look at, well, there's this deepened distrust issue, actually getting worse, the worst I've seen it in a long time. On the other hand, we've got to cut a deal, because we've just basically, this is bottom raw, then we need money. So, you know, you can get into the we don't trust, we don't like you, we don't feel Iraqi, but there's business deals being cut. There's oil that needs to get out. There's money and contracts that need to be paid. So at the end of the day, I don't see, you know, how much more this can go. And I agree with you. I don't see Iraq breaking apart. It will survive. But how long will this peter off? So I think they're going to cut a deal. At the end of the day, I think there will be a deal to be cut. How much they will get, I don't know.
Zal?
Well, I think that, that this is a turning point kind of elections and situation. It's really, it's quite serious. Maybe like perhaps the worst days of 2006. And I think the U.S. factor has reduced dramatically. We still have influence, but has reduced dramatically. and the region has become a lot worse. And therefore, it's particularly dangerous for Iraqis and for Iraq. Now, and this absence of consensus and the rise of what I call smaller identities and politicization of that to a much larger degree than ever before, perhaps. And therefore, really, there are I see three options, and where we can, you know, what role we play could be a factor. One is progress towards a consensus as what it means to be Iraqi and the state, the role of the state, regions, provinces, and what kind of power sharing. Or if that doesn't work, if other trends remain the same, then you decide you look for a strong leader that can bring order, and that leads you toward more authoritarianism, whether it will work or not. If it doesn't work, it will lead to a protracted conflict, and maybe even secession. It is really the things that have not been on the agenda for the past several years because of the progress that was made has come back on the agenda. And it's really a test for the Iraqi leaders in the coming period to rise to the occasion. And I think we also, the neighbors have a stake clearly, but we do too, and what role we play. And I support the idea that I think several colleagues have mentioned that our role has to be one of making using our relations, our assistance, in a broad sense, as you said, to encourage towards the kind of policies that can deal with the other two potential threats of creeping authoritarianism or fragmentation and increased instability. And it's a challenge for us too. I mean, as it is a challenge for the Iraqis, much more for them, but it's also a challenge, a test for the United States, because what will happen in Iraq won't just remain limited to Iraq. It will have broader implications for the entire world. So.
Thank you very much, and I want to just say in concluding that at least we've given the ambassador good reason to report that Iraq is still taken seriously in Washington, at least by this panel. Thank you very much.
Thank you.